The Clone Wars is a good show. A very controversial opinion, I know. It's fun, it's exciting, it's got really great animation and some really intriguing plot lines and world building. It's everything that the prequel movies should have been, and while I don't think they ever set it out right, one of its clear objectives was to fix a lot of the prequel movies' mistakes. For example, making Anakin into an actually likable hero makes his fall a lot more impactful. Same goes for fleshing out the clones and their backstory. Reviving Darth Maul was a stroke of genius since he became one of the best villains in Star Wars. And just in general, exploring all of the interesting stories that can be told in this era of Star Wars. All of this made it one of my favourite shows as a kid. With one exception. Well, two, but I'm not even going to try and redeem the robots wandering through the desert arc. No, as a kid, the most boring episodes of Clone Wars, and the ones I was most likely to skip, were the Padmé episodes. Why? Well, because they're the boring ones, right? They don't have lightsabers, they rarely have clones. Most of the episode generally revolves around people talking in rooms, because Padmé is a senator, not a soldier. They're boring. Or are they? When you look past the superficial elements, the lack of shiny swords on screen, what are they actually in these rooms talking about? As it turns out, some absolutely fascinating things. So, normally when I do a video like this, I come up here and I talk about how so-and-so is deeply underrated, but they're actually one of my favourite characters. Padmé is not that. She's fine. Well, to be honest, if we're talking exclusively about the movies, then she's a little less than fine. She mostly exists because, well, Luke and Leia need a mum. In the movies, Padmé is more of a plot device than she is a character. She exists because Anakin needs a reason to turn to the dark side, and in Revenge of the Sith especially, she's more of a catalyst for his story, rather than having any kind of story of her own. Like pretty much everything else, she's written a lot better in the Clone Wars, with more personality and a lot more agency. But she's still not, like, one of my favourites. She's fine. It's the episodes that she's in and the way that the show uses her character that I find more interesting than the character herself. The Clone Wars is about war. Duh. And throughout the show, it uses various perspectives to show different angles on the war, from the war room to the front lines to the shadowy profiteers and pirates on the sidelines. Padmé is a politician, and her episodes center around the politics of war. But wait, isn't long, boring conversations about politics one of the main critiques of the prequel movies? Why, yes. Yes, it is. Which is why I was not alone in finding these episodes boring as a kid. Every episode of Clone Wars opens with a bit of establishing narration in a kind of war radio presenter kind of way. It'll be like, the vile separatists are mounting a war across the surface of Ryloth, and it'll show clips of people fighting. But then for the Padmé episodes, it'll be like, the banking clan are pushing a bill for the deregulation of government spending, and it'll show a bunch of clips of people arguing in rooms. And it's not that the subject matter is inherently boring, but this is supposed to be a cartoon show for kids, and I think the subject matter being boring for kids is a valid criticism. However, as an adult, I am absolutely fascinated by the banking clan pushing a bill that will deregulate the banks, and I give the show a lot of credit for being willing to tackle such complex issues within the framework of a kids' cartoon show. These episodes are really interesting in both the subject matter and with how they function within the wider Star Wars universe, because the truth is, nobody got closer to stopping the rise of the Empire than Padmé Amidala. There are two major story arcs in the Clone Wars centering on Padmé. The first one covers Season 3 Episodes 10 and 11, ending with Season 2 Episode 15, because for whatever reason Clone Wars was released hilariously out of order. Like, a main character of this arc dies in Season 2, but then is back in Season 3 because they take place directly before that episode of Season 2? It's so weird. Anyway, one of the most important details of Padmé's character that Clone Wars fleshes out is that Padmé is against the war. The majority of the episodes surrounding Padmé, by extension, follow the anti-war movement in the Galactic Senate, which immediately puts on a very different footing from the rest of the series. The Clone Wars is not a pro-war show or anything, but a lot of the characters in the series have an uncritical lens on the war, particularly Anakin. It's a tale of good guys versus bad guys. Fighting is heroic. The Padmé episodes argue for a more complex truth, that even if a war or a battle is just, war is never a net positive, and there are consequences felt by everyone, regardless of if you're on the front lines or not. The show tackles this through the lens of government military spending. Padmé and her cohorts are in opposition to a bill that will lead to the creation of 5 million more clones. We as the audience like the clones. The clones are good old boys. But for these episodes, we're supposed to be on the side of Padmé because of what the cost of those new soldiers actually means. This is how we end up talking about the deregulation of the banks. The Republic is already in debt to the bank, and for new troops they need a loan, a new loan means further debt. And further debt means really bad things for the economy of the Republic. As Padmé learns from one of her handmaidens, the regular people of the galaxy, the people who aren't heroes on the battlefield or politicians living in luxury, are living in poverty. Food shortages, electrical outages, a healthcare crisis. Civil services are being drained in favour of military spending. The banking clan isn't ignorant to these facts, they just don't care. In fact, the banking clan explicitly lends money to both sides of the war in the name of staying neutral.
We will lend the Republic at our standard interest rate of 25%.
What?
25%? That's outright theft!
Your previous arrangement with the Republic was 10%!
Please, please! That was before deregulation. The same rules don't apply, my dear. The Separatists don't seem to mind a rate hike. In fact, they just secured a loan to fund an additional 3 million battle droids.
So if taking out this loan is such an obviously bad idea with long-term consequences, why is it still being passed through anyway? Because of patriotism. When Padmé speaks out against this bill, she's called a spy and a traitor. She's fighting against more soldiers, more protection. The only way to end the war is to win it, right? Despite everything that she does for the Republic, opposition to the war is seen as unpatriotic. If you oppose the war, then clearly that means you want the enemy to win, and they're the bad guys, so clearly you're a bad guy. This outlines a real-world truth. People are very bad at seeing the bigger picture. They focus on what's directly in front of them. We're at war. We need to stop the bad guys. The fallout of what it takes to stop the bad guys is unimportant in the here and now. The banks are relying on that very idea. They're conspiring to keep the war going on longer exactly because it increases their profit margins.
We need fighting to feed the machine and our profits.
Listen, this is still a kid's show. I'm not exposing any hidden subtext here. These episodes are here to underline one very important thing. War is complicated. The true victors of war aren't the people who win on the battlefield, it's the person selling the guns. Why yes, that is also a plot point in The Last Jedi, the best Star Wars film. What a total coincidence. One part of the Jedi's downfall is their failure to understand that complexity. They're on the battlefield, living in the moment-to-moment battles, and they can't see the bigger picture. One of these episodes, called Heroes on Both Sides, in a reference to this line in the opening crawl of Revenge of the Sith that really doesn't make sense for that movie, but it does make sense here, is about Padmé trying to teach Ahsoka, and by extension the audience, about the complexities of the war. This episode starts with Anakin giving his black and white perspective on the war, which is, of course, completely wrong.
War's complicated, Ahsoka, but let me simplify it. The Separatists believe the Republic is corrupt, but they're wrong. And we have to restore order.
Maybe talking to the Jedi Council isn't the role for you after all.
One of the main issues with the prequel movies is that they do a terrible job of explaining what the Separatists actually are. They're more than just a collection of battle droids and the coughing meme man. The line about the Separatists believing the Republic is corrupt is absolutely true, as we've just seen. They're massively in debt to bankers and war profiteers, with many senators openly in the pocket of the bank. The Separatists basically have a point. The only difference is that they're ruled by an openly evil hate wizard and the Republic is ruled by a secret evil hate wizard. Padmé takes Ahsoka to meet an old friend of hers who joined the Separatists, and she and her family are completely normal people. They have different perspectives on the galaxy and the war, but they're not comically evil like Ahsoka thought. The start of a character arc for Ahsoka that culminates with her leaving the Jedi altogether. On Padmé's end, this is technically illegal, as a little detail they mention in this episode is that formal meetings with the opposition is illegal, which is probably why Ahsoka has such a black and white view of them in the first place. But Padmé's friend has sway and is able to talk the Separatist Senate into opening peace talks. This is where we get into the other clever writing at play in these episodes, the way it plays with the prequel problem. Not the Star Wars prequel problem, but more generally, the idea that prequels are harder to write and enjoy because by their very nature, you know how things are going to end. If it's not done well, this can sap drama from scenes a lot of the time. Anytime a character is in danger or about to die, you know it's not going to happen because they still have to be alive by the time of the original media. Padmé's episodes play with that foreknowledge in interesting ways. We know that there's still a war on by the time of Revenge of the Sith. None of Padmé's pushes for peace are actually going to work. So the question becomes, why not? In this case, it doesn't even have anything to do with old Palpy. It's the bankers that conspire to stop the peace talks by setting a bomb off on Coruscant and blaming the Separatists, thereby perpetuating the war. This showcases an important part of Palpatine's schemes, though. He isn't really the corrupting influence on the Republic. He's just playing the game like everyone else. The Senate was corrupt long before his rise to power. He just knows how to use that to his advantage, while the Jedi refuse to accept that there's any corruption in the first place. But that's not even as close as Padmé gets to stopping the war and thereby unraveling Palpy's entire scheme. Fueled by the bombing and the death of her Separatist friend, she's able to give a speech passionate enough to inspire the Senate against the bill for further clone production. And for one of the only times in the series, Palpatine expresses genuine surprise and respect for her diplomatic abilities.
Isn't it remarkable that one can have all the power in the galaxy, and yet the words of a single senator can sway the thoughts of millions?
What do you plan to do about this?
For now, we must adhere to the principles of our democracy. We must let the wheels of the Senate turn.
Dramatic irony is woven throughout Clone Wars when the audience knows something that the characters don't know. We know the entire time that the Clone Wars are fake, all part of Palpatine's plan to become Emperor. And there's a lot of great tension and drama that comes from seeing characters get so close to unraveling the whole thing, but just missing it, either due to Palpy's influence or, in Padmé's case, unlucky coincidence. Palpatine isn't even the one to put a stop to this movement either. A series of unrelated assassinations scares the Senate into pushing the bill forward, and Palpy has the biggest grin on his face when it happens to work out that way. I think an important aspect of Padmé's episodes is how she becomes a figurehead for a different kind of heroism. That being a hero doesn't mean being really good at fighting people. It means standing up for what's right, regardless of what that entails. Padmé's big moments aren't action scenes, although she does get a fair few of those. Her big moments are almost always speeches. It's an important counterbalance to all the stories about traditional heroism, that really, she is the one making the most difference in this war. She's not a traitor for refusing to go along with this war unquestioningly, and ultimately, she's one of the only people not playing into the villain's hands. At least, not most of the time. There is one other significant story arc for Padmé. The sad, sad story of Rush Clovis. Some guy. Rush Clovis is initially introduced in Season 2. He's a representative of the banking clan. Yes, those pesky banks are at it again. And he and Padmé were once romantically involved. The Jedi Council believes that he's secretly working with the Separatists, so they send Padmé in as a spy, hoping she can use her past connection to get close to him and figure out what he's up to. The episode drops the politics in favour of a classic espionage episode combined with some good old-fashioned romantic drama, since any episode with Rush Clovis also establishes something important about Padmé and Anakin's relationship. That actually, it kinda sucks. He's controlling, overprotective, and a condescending asshole with absolutely no filter.
You mean I can't handle the mission?
I mean I'm not gonna let you do it.
You're not going to let me? It's not your decision to make. It's mine.
Lucky for us, you've already decided to refuse.
Actually, I just changed my mind.
Rush Clovis brings out the absolute worst in Anakin. He's not a romantic rival at all. Padmé tells him repeatedly that she has no interest in rekindling their relationship. But Anakin refuses to back down for the entire episode, even leaving Clovis to die at the end out of pure spite. People often say that Clone Wars Anakin feels like a totally different character than the Anakin in the movies, but in these episodes, that petulant brat really shines through. His love for Padmé is not pure, it's obsessive and possessive. He doesn't even really view her as her own person, but rather as an extension of himself, hence his insistence that she can't go on the mission. That lines up perfectly with his actions in Revenge of the Sith, where he decides on his murder children to save my wife plan before actually talking to his wife about it. He's not a very good husband. It's another case where the show's dramatic irony starts to weave in. We know that Anakin becomes Darth Vader. We know that really, Padmé and the entire galaxy would be better off if they broke up. And for a time, they actually do. Clovis returns for a 3-episode run in season 6 as part of Palpatine's plan to completely take over the bank, which goes off without a hitch. But the more interesting part of the story arc to me is how the whole thing almost breaks up Anakin and Padmé's entire marriage. Padmé has to work with Clovis just like before, and again, Anakin is positively dripping with jealousy and resentment that another man is attracted to his wife. It's not that his hatred for Clovis is entirely unwarranted, he's a pushy asshole who Padmé genuinely has no interest in, but his resentment comes out long before that happens. And when he stumbles on Clovis trying to kiss Padmé, he absolutely demolishes him in a full-on brawl, with Padmé shouting to stop the entire time.
Both of you, stop this!
You don't have a say in this!
Protecting your wife is one thing, beating a guy to death in front of your wife while she's telling you to stop is another thing entirely. It directly showcases that Anakin's protectiveness has nothing to do with Padmé as a person and everything to do with his own ego and showcasing that he's some kind of alpha male that can protect his women. Which is why after this fight, Padmé dumps him. For a moment there, she glimpses the truth of the situation and sees how unhealthy this relationship actually is. Once again, unintentionally putting a massive dampener in Palpatine's entire scheme. Palpy is able to fix this one when Padmé is captured as part of his scheme and he makes sure that Anakin is the one who gets to make the daring rescue. But for a brief minute there, the truth of their relationship became clear, and the galaxy could have been very different because of it. When people joke about the Clone Wars not really being a kid's show, they often accompany it with a compilation of violence, of people being stabbed and shot and other such stuff. As if that isn't exactly what the kids are there for. I can tell you what a kid really doesn't care about, and that's the complexities of a failing marriage, or the politics behind banking deregulation. But I think it's to the show's credit that it takes these more grown-up, adult storylines and makes them palatable for a kid's audience. I think it's important to showcase a wider variety of stories to kids, and to showcase that things aren't always so simple. I still don't love Padmé, and quite frankly, I think the show still makes a terrible case for why Anakin and Padmé even like each other in the first place, but I do think that the show would be weaker without these episodes and these explorations into her side of the story. Now, I just need to figure out how to enjoy the Desert Droid Odyssey.
I support our brave soldiers, whether they come from the clone factories or from any of the thousands of systems loyal to the Republic. But if we continue to impoverish our people...
It is not on the battlefield where Dooku will defeat us, but in our own homes. Therefore, it is our duty and our responsibility to preserve the lives of those around us by defeating this bill.
Thank you for watching, and a very special thank you to my patrons for your continued support. If you'd like to see your name up here or get access to Patreon exclusive videos, then please consider signing up, it would mean a lot to me. And you can also help by liking, sharing, commenting, and subscribing. I have plenty more videos about Star Wars, like this one here about Sabine becoming a Jedi and if that's good or bad. Or this video down here about Star Wars Battlefront 2, a game that we definitely all remember, right?